Hey, welcome back to Razorback Reels. I'm Adam Roberts.
And I'm Aaron Imsall.
It's been a long, horrible winter without us, I know, so we'll be here to recap all the movies that you missed over the past few weeks. Stay with us. Hey, welcome back to Razorback Reels. As I said before, we have a lot of movies to cover, a lot of movies that you probably missed, and some that are still in theaters that you still have a chance to check out if you hurry.
Yeah, they're still there. And we didn't get to all the holiday movies, of course, because there was way
No.
too many to get to. But we still picked out a great bunch of ones to showcase today.
So first selection is The Curious Case of Benjamin Button. Of course, starring Brad Pitt in all sorts of wonderful makeup, along with Cate Blanchett. And this is based on a Scott Fitzgerald short story. Not a big Fitzgerald fan, but I did really like Benjamin Button. I thought the acting was great.
Yeah, David Fincher was the director, and I think he produces another great collaboration with Brad Pitt in this. He's also been with him in the past with Fight Club and Seven, and this is a
This is sort
completely
of,
different
yeah,
movie.
I was about to say, it's sort of like Fight Club. I mean, I tried to explain it to my mom after I told her who David Fincher was, and she was like, I don't want to see
It's like,
that.
no, you do want to see this. This is a great movie from, I mean, a lot of people may think it's weird. It's an 80-year-old man. He
Yeah,
goes down to a baby.
it is kind of weird,
It's a
but
little
yeah.
weird, but it's the way they do it is fantastic. The way, it's all about life and having regrets in life. And I mean, this movie is like life and death companion. And if you have problems wondering about death and life, this movie will mess you up because he definitely goes into this realm and takes you out of it, but.
Right. It's another one of these movies where it takes, like a personal story and it sets it against the backdrop of American history. It's something like Forrest Gump or from, Britt and Cavalcade, and it's, sort of that only for the early 1900s. And, maybe you won't have the nostalgic crowd like you did for Forrest Gump since most of the people alive then aren't alive anymore, but it's still really interesting. I normally don't care for period pieces, but I really like this. I thought it was well done, well acted all around, and the makeup wasn't distracting. Instead, it really helped with the character. Really good, really great.
Yeah, speaking of the makeup, the CG that they used, along to make Brad Pitt look
Right.
younger and to make him look older, I thought was fantastic. Some people were
Oh.
complaining, like, oh, the CG was still too distracting. And I was like, no way.
No.
It was perfect. I mean, this is one of some of the best cases of CG,
Right. This
ever.
is how it should
This is
be
how it should be.
used.
It's not
Right.
distracting. It's just there. Unless you're really trying to fine
Which
tune,
part
like,
is
wait a minute,
this?
there it is.
Yeah.
I see some CG. I mean, no, this movie is done very well from start to finish. And actually, I think it started off a little slow. I was kind of like, all right.
I could see
And then
that.
boom, for like another
Yeah.
2 hours and 20 minutes, I was entranced by it. And from his 80-year-old looking dude to all the way to the end. I don't want to give it away,
Yeah, don't
but
spoil anything. Well, you saw a movie that might appeal to some of the Twilight fans and non-fans.
yeah, the real movie that we should have seen instead of Twilight, Let the Right One In. There we have is Let the Right One In, and it's a Swedish film. And I told Adam that if Ingmar Bergman was still alive and he would want to make a vampire movie, he would make this movie. This is the movie he would make. It's and like Twilight, there's a relationship, only it's between two like 12-year-old. It's a boy, Oscar, who we saw there, that extremely blonde-haired boy, and this vampire in a girl's body, so to speak. And they kind of have this bond that they develop. They're both kind of in bad situation and bad circumstances, and they kind of develop this bond, and they kind of become friends, and they want to help each other out. And they each do help each other out throughout the movie. And I don't want to give away any like core plot points or anything, but this movie is shot like a Bergman film in many ways. There's a lot of shots of snow. It's kind of dreary, kind of depressing in states, but also at the same time, it makes you think about the relationships you have in life and the friendships you have in life. And I highly recommend this. It's not going to be nominated for an Academy Award, unfortunately, because of bad rules, but it
Don't just
deserves to
love the
be. It deserves to be there in the
Oscars.
best foreign film. It's excellently done. It's not a vampire film per se. There are some blood. You're going to see some blood in this movie, but they don't concentrate on the blood. The blood's just kind of a side
Finally, so
part.
there's no Oh, blood. Yeah.
Yeah, there's a little bit of blood in this, but it's
Okay.
very minimal, and it's kind of like a side part of it. I mean, you can't do a vampire movie without any blood when there are some deaths, but the most important part of the characters in this, in the relationship between the two characters, even
Okay.
more so.
Well, I never understand those, Norway and Sweden always score so highly on these happiness surveys, but their films are always so depressing.
This movie's still a little depressing. Not as depressing as other movies out in the cinema right now, but this is still a little bleak. I mean, it's Swedish,
Well,
and the landscape is depressing in Sweden, but.
speaking of vampires, Frost Nixon is our next
Ooh.
film we reviewed. Let's play a clip.
I shall resign the presidency at noon tomorrow.
This is an historic day, the only time a president has ever resigned from office.
Nixon knew about the Watergate cover-up.
The man who has committed the greatest felony in American history will never stand trial.
I've had an idea for an interview, Richard Nixon.
You're a talk show host.
I spent yesterday watching you interview the Bee Gees.
Weren't they terrific?
Why would I want to talk to David Frost? I got
All right, well, I really enjoyed this. This is a film that's really just built around the individual performances in the movie. You have, Michael Sheen and Frank Langella as David Frost and Richard Nixon. And this is directed by Ron Howard. I guess I didn't do my research before I went in, but it wasn't until I saw the credits play, I was like, oh, really? So I was really impressed. I'm not a big Ron Howard fan, so I liked it. It, tells the story of David Frost was a talk show host, decides to interview Richard Nixon, and I guess I won't, it's historical, but I won't spoil the ending anyway, in case you're not too familiar with the whole story. But I really, really enjoyed this. I thought it's sort of a nice counterpoint to W, instead of being, some people felt they were maybe too nice to George Bush and W. They humanize Richard Nixon, but they're not too nice to him. So I really did enjoy this movie.
And that aspect is kind of what the film deals with, is are we going to make Richard Nixon, look better in the eyes of the public, or are we going to demonize him like kind of what they wanted to, at least some of the back, the guys in the back wanted to do. Which, again, we got another great performance from Sam Rockwell in this, who just nonstop great performances. He plays an advisor to Snow there, or David Frost. David Frost. And then
Kevin
he's
Bacon,
also,
right?
And Kevin Bacon is Richard Nixon's advisor, and very good supporting cast here. Now, I didn't love this, I don't think, quite as much as you, even though it's a B+, but I know we've talked a little bit
different
on this.
Standards, right?
But I still think it was solid. It's a good film, to get the story behind it. Although it's not completely 100% accurate, they messed up some timelines and
I
stuff like they do
about
in movies.
All that.
It's still a good story to see, kind of how Richard Nixon was in these interviews. Because probably most of us watching this did not see these interviews, or not even most of us are not even aware of these interviews, even in
and
the past. So.
I just love the David Frost character. I came out of there, seemed sort of like James Bond, only instead of shooting people, he goes on talk shows.
Yeah.
I was like, hey, I could do that. It seems great.
He's such a loose, kind of what you expect from the British
it's
in the 70s.
Hey,
like, hey,
you
going out.
Television. Yeah.
Making a
where,
movie.
Where doesn't cross the line into Austin Powers territory, but
no.
It kind of it's the
you
same
see it.
Character.
You
right.
can see it coming, the Austin Powersness. But he's great. And Michael Sheen, who plays that, who we're going to see next week in the new Underworld movie, who plays a werewolf. But he was so good
you
in
won't
this
recognize
too.
Him.
And I think if anybody deserves a nomination, they've talked about both of them. I actually think Michael Sheen
I
deserves
did
it
like
more
Michael
than.
Sheen.
More than
I mean, even with that big monologue that Frank Langella gives, I still like Michael Sheen better.
I agree totally. I think he was perfect in that role.
Well, Gran Torino featuring Clint Eastwood, directed by Clint Eastwood, written by Clint Eastwood. Let's play
music by Clint Eastwood.
Try and play a clip from that.
Ever notice how you come across somebody once in a while that you shouldn't have fought with? That's me.
Okay, that's Gran Torino, Clint Eastwood's everything movie that he includes singing the song at the end of the movie.
His son wrote the score.
So the score, and he co-wrote it as well. This movie's basically like Dirty Harry retired and at the end of his life, and he's not going to take any more crap from anybody anymore. And it's all about kind of also about race relationships between this old white dude that fought in Korea and has these negative stereotypes about Asians in general, even though these are Hmong people living next door, not Koreans, and he doesn't want he doesn't want anything to do with them. He's very spiteful, looks at them, he wants no relations at all. And then because of events that happen that you'll see in the trailer, you know, where, oh, get off my lawn. You know, he'll do that whole thing. And
right.
And then all of a sudden, you know, he tries to learn that, hey, you know, they're people too kind of thing. It's one of those movies like Big Kumbaya. Hey, we're both people. Oh, white people are all right.
Spoiled the ending.
Wrong people are all right.
I thought this reminded me of maybe John Wayne from The Searchers appearing in Shane. You know, sort of have Shane only just a total, you know, Shane.
Very racist, imagine just hates, like John Wayne was.
Imagine Shane hates everybody, and you still have the same basic idea.
Yeah,
you know, Clint Eastwood is devoted, you know, at the last 30 some odd years of his life to looking at, you know, American manhood and how we relate and what it means to be a man. And, you know, he deals with it pretty explicitly here. And I thought that the way he, you know, chooses to end the film is a really great counterpoint to Unforgiven.
Mm-hmm.
You know, instead of, you could probably title a film Forgiven instead of Unforgiven.
Mm-hmm.
So I really enjoyed the movie on that aspect of it, even though I thought it wasn't really the greatest movie. I mean, Clint Eastwood is Clint Eastwood. Everybody else, the acting was kind of shaky. Action wasn't really there. But as a concept, I really liked it.
I think the story was great. I think the only weakness in this movie was the actors that played the Hmong, the neighbors next door. I really think they could have done the research and got maybe a little more experienced actors, because I think they're kind of weak in the movie and they take you out of the moment, and many times you'll just kind of be like, oh, come on, these actors.
Yeah.
It's like, oh, because they've got better actors here. It really takes you out of the moment. But I thought the story was really good, and I thought it was funny. Did not expect it to be funny at all.
I did not expect
the comedy, but it had a lot of comedy.
The trailer had no comedy. I was ready for, you know, Unforgiven again, and said everybody's laughing the whole time in the theater. I'm like, oh, okay, I guess this is funny.
No, I thought it was kind of a heartwarming film by the end. At first, I was a little like, oh, okay, this gruff Clint Eastwood thing is getting a little old, but it grew on me, and I ended up really liking the movie by the end.
And a movie that people were not laughing in the theater at was Bride Wars.
Or maybe.
Wedding dates have been booked on the same day. Which one of you wants to choose another venue?
What? One of us will just have to get married on a different day. One of us will have to be flexible.
Well, one of us can look at different venues.
Yeah, one of us could.
It's crazy. They haven't spoken for like a week. It's like a century in girls' ears.
You send out your save the dates?
Surprised?
Your wedding better watch it.
If I were your wedding, I'd be sleeping with one eye open.
You're right. Your wedding will be huge, just like your at prom.
All right, Bride Wars. The trailer has all the funny parts. I hate it so much when they do that. I came into the movie expecting a pretty good film because the trailer did make me laugh a lot. I love Anne Hathaway, but the whole movie, it was pretty much just sitting there looking at the watch, waiting around for them to say some of the lines from the trailer. And this is just a predictable film. It was half an hour before they actually got past the initial setup and into the juiciness of the plot. And you can't do that when the entire audience already knows the plot. You can't bring up the twist once the story's been going for half an hour. It's just a waste of time. It seemed like they wrote the movie and then they were like, oh, this is only 20 minutes long. What are we going to do? It was co-written by Casey Wilson, a new Saturday Night Live player. And I like her in the movie. She plays a small role. I hope that she didn't have too much to do with the writing because it wasn't very good.
Well,
two actresses, very underused.
Well, somebody that was a big fan of 27 Dresses about a year ago, when I was sat in this seat, was not interested in this movie at all. The trailer did not do anything for me. I knew this was going to be a stink bomb, and it lived up to its name.
I thought it was going to be funny. I was very disappointed. Well, maybe if I came into it with your expectations, I would have been like, eh, but...
Well, I'm glad to see it was horrible like I was hoping.
Right, but. So, I mean, if you're getting married and you have some obsessive compulsive disorder that you have to see every movie made about a wedding, see Bride Wars, otherwise... Don't do anything.
We'll stick to that advice. Don't stay away.
We do have 6 more movies to review, but we have a trivia question for you. We have My Bloody Valentine 3D we'll be talking about shortly. So we want to know if you can tell us what 1954 film did Alfred Hitchcock release in 3D? And Dial M for Murder was Alfred Hitchcock's 3D release.
I wish I could have saw it in 3D. It was a great movie.
I know. I wonder if there's some way you can get a hold of a copy in 3D, get the little glasses and DVD.
That would be awesome. That would be awesome.
I remember in the movie, though, I'm not really... I don't remember anything jumping out at the screen like it's trying to be 3D.
I still would like it, I think.
I'm not sure how much...
Now,
but Grace Kelly in 3D, hey.
Yeah, you know. I'm sure it would have been a great 3D film, but probably nothing like our next movie, My Bloody Valentine 3D.
Let's just play the trailer.
Exactly what did you see?
Something was following us.
This is the most horrific event this town has ever seen. Authorities are calling this the Valentine's Day Massacre.
In the town of Harmony, something unexplainable.
Hello?
Is happening.
Come here, you better check this out.
All right, My Bloody Valentine 3D. As you can see on your screen, I like it a little more than Adam does as far as grade-wise. And maybe this movie is a D, My Bloody Valentine graded D, but when you throw in the 3, it turns and flips over to a B because the 3D really does make it worth it to watch. The 3D adds so much character to this movie that otherwise would not be there. There's nothing like seeing a spike go through someone's head and see blood and like specks of skull come flying at you in the audience. That was so great. This movie, it's a standard 80s, late 80s horror movie plot that you know there's, it could possibly be one or two, maybe three people. Who is it going to be? Oh, wait, it's him. Oh, no, it's him. And then, oh, it's him. But forget all that. This movie is great because of the great 3D concept that they use effectively throughout the whole movie. Not just for the gimmicks, which there's the gimmicks, you know, where he peeks in and he moves the little thing across the screen.
I thought that was the only great part about the 3D. The rest of the movie is so dark. I couldn't tell if I was watching it in 3D or not because it looked so flat because it was dark all the time.
Oh, check your vision. It was great what I saw. Maybe I saw it.
I want to know.
Your glasses were foggy.
I want to know what you have to do to get an NC-17 rating nowadays.
NC-17?
You have like several minutes of full frontal female nudity. You have more violence than I've ever seen. Some nudity. I saw so much graphic, like the most graphic violent. I mean, maybe somewhere short of Cannibal Holocaust. This is the most graphic violence.
I don't remember being
seen.
That graphic.
This is if you saw Grindhouse, the double feature with, you know, Tarantino and Rodriguez. It reminded me of the Planet Terror segment of it. Only Planet Terror.
What's wrong with that?
Planet Terror was a lot of fun to watch.
Yeah.
My Bloody Valentine 3D. You were like,
this is fun.
The only reason you were terrified was because you didn't want to see somebody's jaw get cut off again.
That was fun. It was fun in 3D.
I was trying to have fun, but there were a few parts that were fun, but most of the movie was all right.
You gave Bride Wars a better grade than this, Adam. You gave Bride Wars a D+. You gave it almost.
I did give Bride because even though I didn't like Bride Wars, I was only bored by it. I wasn't in physical pain watching the movie.
This movie is not that bad. Adam, with his weak stomach and his foggy glasses, may not like this. But if your glasses, clean off those 3D glasses. I did twice
to make sure that I was.
Wipe them clean. Right. Watch it. Enjoy the 3D flying at you. It is so fun.
If you're 16 years old, your parents have the internet filter on. Go sneak into the movie. Otherwise, no one else is going to enjoy this.
No, it's a very fun movie. If you like horror movies, especially like those late 80s horror movies, this is a fun time. The story is not great, don't get me wrong.
If you thought Grindhouse was too clever and funny for you, well, go ahead.
All right, let's go on to something a little more somber, a little more serious. We're talking Will Smith, 7 Pounds.
When you sign your name, you'll own my house. I only ask that you never try to contact me for any reason.
Why me?
It is within my power to drastically change his circumstances, but I don't want to give that man a gift that he doesn't deserve.
What are you planning to do?
All right, there's no graphic nudity or jaws being ripped off in this one, but you do have a somber Will Smith throughout the whole movie with a concerned look on his face the whole time. Very sad, no jovial Will Smith. You got the sad Will Smith. And this movie has a big twist that I'm not going to go into, but the movie's basically about this guy trying to find these people out, to try to help these people out, and you don't really know why. And basically, if I tell you why, this will ruin the whole reason to even see this movie. This movie's adequate. It's a C movie. We've been very insistent about what a C means.
C is average.
It's average.
Not bad.
It was an average movie. You know, there were some emotional parts in this movie, and this movie wants you to get emotional. They really want to hit home their point throughout the whole movie. Like, oh,
Kleenex baby.
Oh, she has cancer. Oh, he's blind. You know, oh, no. It's like they take every bad scenario you can possibly take to make you feel like a horrible human being. You know, and they're like, oh, why am I not doing something here? And they hit it home. And they hit it home with Will Smith with that expression that never changes throughout the whole movie. And I actually don't think Will Smith does a good job in this movie. I think I don't know if it's his fault or what. I don't know if he's directed wrong. I just didn't like the way this movie was set up. I think it was a great concept. I think the concept works. I think there's moments in this that, you know, that will touch you if you have a heart or a soul, which sometimes we worry about Adam, but I think there are moments in this, but that will touch you. But in all, I don't know. I know that that Bailey likes this movie. She's a big fan, but
just promise me that the plot twist isn't like the one in Hancock.
Well, let's just say there
is. Promise me he's not some super space alien with.
I can't go there. I don't want to ruin it. I don't want to ruin it. But maybe he's a superhero. Will Smith likes the twist recently, but I don't know. This movie was all right. If you love those emotional movies that really creep at you and pull on the heartstrings, you might like this. If not, skip it.
Well, Valkyrie is one that's been controversial with critics. We agreed, so let's see a trailer for that.
Gentlemen. We can save Europe from total destruction. We have to show the world
that not all of us were like him.
It is too great a risk. It doesn't change what we must do.
What did you have in mind?
You could serve Germany or the Fuhrer.
All right, Valkyrie with Tom Cruise, known as sort of the big Tom Cruise disaster. All the critics have been playing it up before they even saw the movie. I enjoyed this. I didn't think it was a bad film. I gave it a B-, well above average. It follows the historical story really pretty close to the truth. I was surprised once I read about it afterwards. It's about a conspiracy to assassinate Hitler, and things go pretty well except for one small detail. I'll let the movie tell you I'll let the movie tell you what that is. But I mean, I really enjoyed this. I thought Tom Cruise did a good job. The entire cast did a good job. It wasn't anything great, but I really enjoyed it. It had me guessing a lot, and it wasn't one of these. I mean, I've criticized these movies before that shows Nazis. You can tell who the bad guys are by you get a scowl and just kind of glare the whole time. This is one where you see even these horrible Nazis as whole people, and you get a real feel for who they are. Without making without being too sympathetic to Nazism. So I really enjoyed it from that angle.
Yeah, I thought they laid out the story really well and they stuck to it and they followed the story. Now, I don't think it ever reaches to like the point where it becomes something, better than just a really laid out good story and, with actors that are, decent in their part. I don't think Tom Cruise is great by any means in this, but I think he plays the role as Tom Cruise has come to show us how he can play a role. Now, there's no accents in this, and everybody criticized him like, it's Tom Cruise in an eye patch is all it is. It's Top Gun. It's Maverick in an eye patch, this movie. But you know what? I'm all right with that. If nobody else is speaking with a German accent, and it's like much better that they do this than to do some horrible Costner-like German accent. It's the Kevin Costner rule, I told you.
Exactly.
It's better than to go with no accent than give us this horrible accent. So
it's not like they just pretended no one had accents in the beginning. They set it up where he's speaking in German and they have the voiceover where he's talking in, American accent. So I completely bought into it. I'm perfectly fine with that.
Yeah, nobody spoke with a German accent, so who cares? Yeah, if everybody's speaking an English accent, then, I can buy it. If it's when he's the only person not speaking, that's when it gets weird.
Yeah, that's when it gets like George C. Scott as Ebenezer Scrooge.
You're like, huh, what?
Yeah.
But it was a good movie. Not a great movie. I don't think there's anything that sets it apart, in my opinion. Right. But
so it's something to see, but not must-see.
Exactly. Next movie is a must-see. Slumdog Millionaire, my favorite movie of the year. Roll it.
Welcome to Who Wants to Be a Millionaire?
I hope you were paying attention to what was played there, because that's all I'm going to really tell you about the movie. It's basically about a kid that goes on to Who Wants to Be a Millionaire, India style, and he's a slum dog. He grew up in the slums, and he has a reason for being on there. I'm not going to tell you. And the big controversy is, did he cheat? Is he lucky? How does he know these answers? Why is he doing so well? He's trying to win 20 million rupees. And it's kind of explains how he got to all these scenarios and how these questions that were given to him, how he was able to answer them and how he was getting there. And it kind of tells you in backstory, it goes back and let's see how it does it. And it tells his story living in the slums and the relationship he has with his brother and with another girl. And it's an excellent movie. Within 2 minutes, you'll be hooked, and you won't look at your watch. You won't wonder how long it is. You won't wonder anything. You'll just want to see what happens next. It's about a two-hour film, but it flies by. It seems like it's 30 minutes. So, it goes by so well.
Golden Globe Best Picture pick.
Excellent movie, and for the first time in forever, I totally almost agree with the Hollywood Foreign Press. I thought they did an excellent job this year, including by giving all those awards to Slumdog Millionaire. It totally deserves it.
And, you know, we'll get this in Fayetteville sometime before... the Academy Awards ceremony might not be till the day before, but it'll at least be out sometime.
It's releasing to 1,000 theaters next week, so cross your fingers. It might be here in Fayetteville next week. It's got a good chance. Danny Boyle directed this, and he also directed movies like Trainspotting and Shallow Grave, and he's done a wide variety of movies. And he's excellent movie. Cannot recommend it more. It's got action. It's got comedy. Mm-hmm. It's got it all. Great movie.
If you're not in the mood for something heartwarming, go see The Unborn.
When I got here, and the four-year-old conked out as soon as I read to him.
Hang on.
Some people are doorways. What are you doing, Maddie? You have to go back. He wants to be born now.
All right, The Unborn. If you've seen The Exorcist, you've seen this movie. That being said, there are some creative twists in this that you take some horror movie staples like the mirror in the bathroom gag, and it changes it up just enough for me to be like, all right, that was very creative. So that's why I got the C-. Otherwise, you've seen this movie 100 times. It's The Exorcist Light, only with Jews instead of Catholics. Seen it before. If you really like horror movies, see it. Otherwise, I wouldn't
bother. It's PG-13,
Exorcist. For a PG-13 horror movie, it was very good. But that being said, PG-13 horror movies are
I kind of wanted to see it, standard. But didn't catch it. Maybe I still will. I don't know.
Well, a movie that I will be catching when it comes out is one Aaron saw already.
The Wrestler, starring Mickey Rourke.
Great to meet you.
One, two, real!
That's right, Mickey Rourke as the Wrestler. He won Best Actor at the Golden Globes, and he definitely deserves it. This is a Darren Aronofsky film. He's done movies like Requiem for a Dream and The Fountain. He's a tremendous director, and he does a tremendous job in this movie, only in a totally different style. It's a heartwarming story about an ex-professional wrestler who was on par with like Brutus the Barber Beefcake or Jake the Snake Roberts. Huge star, and then as 20 years goes by, his life crashes down. It's not the late 80s anymore. Now it's the 2009, and he's playing American Legion halls and little town fairs and stuff. And he's no longer the star, but he's still trying to hold on to this dream, but the dream's just not there anymore. And he has to come to realization that he gave up his whole life to live this dream, and now he has nothing to hold on to.
So it's like a Fitzgerald story. Yeah.
It kind of is. But it's so well done. Mickey Rourke becomes this character. Mickey Rourke is so incredible, this almost because it follows Mickey Rourke's career almost to
there
a point.
Go.
And maybe he's actually, when he's crying because it's like, this is me. But oh man, if you like professional wrestling, you should have driven somewhere to see this by now. It'll definitely hit home.
I'll be seeing it as soon as I can.
It's a great film. I can't recommend this any higher.
Well, we gave you a bunch of reviews. Stick tuned for next week. We'll have our Silver Reels nominees up. Thank you so much to Fiesta Square, by the way. You can go check movies out there. $4 any weekday or on weekends before 4 o'clock. I'm Adam.
And I'm Aaron.
We'll see you next Monday.